wonderful event on the eve of Women's Day. Actually, not on the eve, one day before Women's Day, Women in Education. And I'm feeling very lucky to be sitting right in the middle of two very esteemed ladies on a very interesting day. So, without wasting any further time, let's quickly jump into the discussion. And yes, a small request, if I could just request all of you to put your phones on silent. To start with, Dr. Roy, you had a very illustrious career which spans more than 30 years. How has been the journey?
Thank you for asking me. I'm very passionate about my job. I started as a teacher teaching adolescent children of age group 17, 18. And that in itself, I will not say was very challenging, but very encouraging. One, over the time you realize they listen to you, they connect to you. Even if they connect to a teacher more than they connect to their parents at that age. So, and being a teacher, you can do a whole lot of things for them. You can guide them in the right direction. You have to do it very subtly, of course. They are adolescent boys and girls. They don't have the habit of listening to you. But I worked for a long time in Shanties. And then I became the principal of this school, Basava International School. So from teaching in the classrooms, and taking care of, say, 200 or 300 children, to taking care of 1600, 1700 at a time was a very big challenge or a great leap forward, I'd say. Over the years, we have worked differently. Over the years, the classroom scenario has changed. So new kinds of challenges have come to the lives of school teachers. So from my grassroots level experience, I can guide my teachers. One thing has remained constant, that is the bonding between a teacher and the students. That remains, and that is the most gratifying of jobs, I think. We never regret being a teacher. And when they grow up, I will say in my 30 years, they pop up everywhere. Wherever you go, yeah. One or the other person will come towards me. And he said, "You are my homeroom teacher." And nothing can be more fulfilling than this feeling. So it's I really love my job and I'm very happy to be a teacher. Thank you.
That's wonderful. The only thing I worry over here is when a man runs with somebody, it only gives away your age. If I taught this particular man, it will be really bad that day. So coming, sorry for the humor, bad humor. Harshali, you've been through a lot of careers, right? You've been an educationist, you've been a lawyer, you know, and actually she's hammered a lot of companies as a consumer forum role in that avatar. She has been with kids. You've been an author and you've been a painter. She has some wonderful paintings with a lot of exhibitions. How do you manage so many roles and how has your journey been?
First of all, good evening. Thank you so much for spending your precious time with us. Very truly, you said I've changed a lot of careers. And I don't know whether it is jack of all trades or just my need to learn more. I think it's the, you know, this instinct inside me that, you know, now I want to learn something else. Though I think I normally tend to go with the flow. And so when I started, in my college, I was training as an occupational physiotherapist. So I trained as that, got married, had children very early, and my husband being a doctor, I was almost a single parent. So then I couldn't, both of us couldn't be out of the house, since we were in a nuclear family. And so then I thought, okay, what is, you know, and women think that, oh, teaching me chale jao, so you'll be back by 3 o'clock and you can take care of the house.
That's a
misconception, a big one. But my mother was a teacher and a principal, so I'd seen her that way, but she was in the government school. So that was a very different ballgame altogether. So in that, with that in mind, I kind of got into education as a teacher initially, did my BA. Then as an administrator, opened my own school, and I was is more associated with the preschool, primary group. So as an in charge, etc. So 15 years down the line, consumer forum happened, and I shifted gears again. Did my LLB, LLM, and then while I was doing it, I was also working at
the consumer.
So I got myself enrolled for a PhD program. I will be doing it in a structured manner. But that brought a lot of problems because there was no reference scale, nobody worked on this area. I didn't have any, I think only two people in other countries worked on this. So I started going to the slums. Every Saturday, Sunday, I have spent time with them, I'm sitting with them. For quite some time, they were not open to it. They will not disclose anything. But afterwards, they started opening up. And I have seen the same story. I have visited many slums of them. And the same story. They actually did not know how to go about it. But they know that if their children go to school, they will come out of this. So for them, the school was the window to future. And these children also were very ambitious. For my PhD, I interacted with children of the same age group, 9 to 12 plus children. And they wanted to be something. Lots of interviews I have done, they don't want to be what their parents are, and they want some, they have the same ambition as the regular children of middle class homes. So they wanted to be doctors, they wanted to be engineers, but very few of them are much aware of vocational education or any different kinds of profession like dancer or singer. They all wanted to have a job after the schooling. And parents were also saying that whatever we have to do, we'll do for that. So over the time, my data piled up, and through proper structure, I could analyze that data, and I could observe through my data that the number of regular employment for say skilled or semi-skilled people have gone up over the years compared to the those daily wage earners, so that NSS later revealed that. So that clearly shows that people are going to school, getting some education, more and more jobs were created in the services sector that my research shows, and to get those services sector jobs, you need some education, because if the person has to work at the computer in a retail shop or doing some courier job, they have to be educated. So some children are not looking at high-end jobs. They were looking at this low-end white-collar jobs, and that has improved the employment scenario in the slums. The slum literacy, my research also shows that slum literacy between 2001 and 2011 has gone up. So it was very heartening, but when my research was done, I got a lot of appreciation for that from university professors, but I thought if I keep it in the form of research, it will just decorate the shelves of universities and only limited number of people will know. If I can get it published in the form of book, then many more people will get to know. See, as an individual, my capacity is limited. But while doing this research, I found there are lots of issues with these children. For example, English. So although English is their language of aspiration, but they do not have the mastery over the language. So children who are going to Hindi medium schools or regional language schools, their academic performance was much better compared to those who are going to English medium schools. But still parents want them to go to English medium school. Now who will help them in learning this English language? In school, as the principal of the school, I see we have a lot of EWS children, 25% of them coming and studying with regular children. Other than language issue, they have other, I'll say psychological issues also. Knowingly or unknowingly, we do not know whether we have help them, or we have strengthened that invisible divide between them. So, for example, children often do not want, of this age group, do not want their parents to meet their friends' parents because they have that inferiority complex. So we need a lot of counseling for these children. Although I do it at personal level, but I do it for my school children or some others. If my book is published, people get to, I have written all this in the book. So if people get to know about that, there are so many people who are doing so many work here and there. So maybe some of them will take care of these children. So that was the purpose of writing this book. Thank you.
That's a very elaborate point, and I want to bring it to the audience before I come to Harshali. How many of you visited a slum ever? That's very interesting. How many have seen a school in a slum? Not the government schools. The non-government schools. Right? How many of you actually know that Delhi also has one single room schools run by NGOs? You'll be surprised. There are a lot of schools that are there, one single room, all classes studying in that single room. And some of those people are actually coming out with flying colors. So what she's talking about, the fact that they study because they want to come out of that rut, is very, very true. They have that very, very, very strong ambition that I have to pull myself and my family out of. In fact, I would say that, the regular schools, kids have privilege to think about careers that may not be paying. But these guys, they don't have the privilege to even dream about a career that may not be paying. Reference being, being an artist, which has emoluments coming in much later in life. They want immediately paying jobs. So that is one agency and one privilege that we have, they don't. And I think that point was very made over there. And one more thing, how many of you have been in schools in Delhi which had EWS sections? Do you remember your EWS classmates? Do you realize that those kids who are coming from a economically weaker section, which is EWS, will always stay in a different zone, stay away, not mix too much, and when they would mix, they would have one small barrier in their mind. As she said, that they always would come up with the inferiority complex about multiple things. Some people get more aggressive because of the complex. Some people become very, very subdued because of the complex. But then they are able to get over that. So that's another very interesting observation that you've made. Coming to Harshali now.
Excuse me, sir.
Thoda matlab bilkul main Hindi mein. Ji ji, bilkul.
I'm expecting another child. So four kids are waiting. I am just the luck.
Okay, coming back to the panelists again, and now something slightly away from the books and about this, let's talk a bit about women in education. Dr. Rasha, I think it's you, kaha jata hai ki this is one sector which is positively biased towards women, matlab aurte zyada hai is profession mein. So is that the reality, that women work more in education? Is that the is that the truth, or is something else? And the question is parallel to both of you, starting with you.
This is very true that education is women's majority of people in education are women. But the cause is not that they are biased. It is biased for in favor of women. I am a student of economics, so women are in education because it is a lowly paid area, and they are not the major bread earners so far. So women are in education, as Harshali also mentioned, that after marriage they think that oh, school mein kaam karegi to ghar bhi sambhal legi. But they do not realize that actually it is almost a 24/7 job, and more women are there because society so far did not think that they can be the major bread earner in our patriarchal system, and they could afford. Many of them did not even think about it, but as I am an economics student, I have this observation that if you compare the qualification of a teacher with that of any other person in any other job with similar qualification, they have been earning almost 3 times more than a teacher. But teachers, in a different way, teacher, women are actually suitable for taking care of children. I think they are by nature better equipped to handle children because they are calm and they have patience. They will not, if men are around, they may give a tight slap. But women know how to control their anger and how to control their emotion, and they will get the work done. So that quality is one essential quality in a teacher, that you may be very angry with that child, but you cannot let it come out of you. You have to control your anger and you have to be on the job. So they are suitable in a way, but the reason why they came initially in school job, because it was kind of their secondary breadwinners in the family. But now with so much changes in the pay structure and all, I will not say it is exactly a lowly paid job. So now more and more people are coming to school job who are very well qualified and who are taking it as another profession. And the same way men are also coming. Thank you.
I'm on a lighter note, picked up something from what Dr. Roy said. So, aap agree karte hain ki some roles and some jobs are more suitable to women.
So,
yeah, right.
The
gender concept is changing, society is changing. So, if you can train the boys from the very beginning, maybe they will also know how to take care of children, because we are also seeing single fathers who are bringing up their children wonderfully. I'm personally seeing a lot of them in school.
Good. Yeah. Okay. Gaon mein zyada Master ji.
So Master ji. Again, if he lets him bahar nahi jaye padhne, or he said, I think that government school teachers have no option, so they go to those villages to teach. But they are not taken very kindly there. So it's more men-centric in villages. And in the schools, in the private and government schools mein to male female dono hai. Private schools mein zyada female teachers hoti hain, or kam male teachers. And again, at the high class, college, university, of men and
काफी इंटरेस्टिंग ऑब्जर्वेशन है हर्षाली जी. यू स्पेंड अ लॉट ऑफ टाइम इन एजुकेशन, सो व्हाट्स योर ओपिनियन ऑन दिस?
आई कंप्लीटली एग्री विद यू एक्चुअली. नो नो, आई डू. आई वाज गोइंग टू कम टू दैट, बट आई वांटेड टू स्टार्ट विद दिस. आई थिंक व्हाट यू वर सेइंग एसेंशियली, इफ वी गो अ लिटिल बिट थोड़ा सा पीछे चलें, तो हम देखें कि आवर मदर्स, मोस्ट ऑफ माय मदर्स जनरेशन, the generation above mine, were mostly teachers, because उस time में girls के पास सिर्फ एक या दो options होते थे, या तो doctor बन जाए या teacher बन जाए. मतलब basically, especially small town, my mother's from Ambala, so उनका ये था, बड़ी sister ने B.Ed करी है तो छोटी sister भी करेगी, उसके बाद बड़ी sister भी करेगी, तो everybody became a teacher. So that is how it went. I think थोड़ा सा mindset ये था कि that was the most dignified position a woman could hold, and hence everybody wanted to become, go into the education sector, whoever, the girls who wanted to earn, yeah, who wanted to work, jinhone, you know, they had done Hindi or English or whatever subject they had chosen. So I think that is where it stemmed from initially. Ab kya hua hai ki when I went to the education sector, that is what I had seen with my mother, that she used to come back home at 2:30 and she used to be in the house and take care. So in my mind, that is how schools work. It was only that I joined a private school, and then I realized that 4 baje tak to matlab meeting hi bulai ja rahi hai. Madam, please come, we want to have a board meeting. I said 4 baje board meeting, to mere bacche to ghar mein rehte hain. So you know, that's how things changed from my mother's time to my time. And then yes, as she very correctly said, that it became a 24/7 job where you were on the job all the time. As a teacher, you still have the the leniency to kind of break away. कि आप घर आ गए तो आप copies ले आए or whatever, you have that that space. But if you're in administration, you're a principal or an in charge, You are on 24/7. You are talking to the parents, you are a counselor, you are a teacher's counselor, you are everything all in one. You know, and so there is no break at all. So, I also agree that pay grade is a very big issue. That is another conversation altogether.
That is parity.
No, I mean, all the, even what the male teachers are getting paid as much.
Yeah, what
I mean is that healthcare and healthcare or education may sabse zyada paid karna chahiye, so that your teachers and your healthcare personnel and your police actually should be satisfied ki, you know, kahin se idhar udhar na jaane ki zarurat pade. So that was one very important point that I said.
I also, after the 7th pay, 6th pay commission came into picture, I myself did some calculations, and if you go by the number of days teachers work and number.
Which country in the world has recently made teaching the highest paid profession? Anybody? You can raise your hands. It's a country near us. Vicinity in Aspasa.
Teaching the highest
paid.
Singapore?
No.
China.
Just waiting for you to go there and start teaching. They pay the highest.
Singapore pays well,
but they're not the highest.
Singapore pays well.
It pays well, but they've not made it the highest paying profession. No. No.
Pakistan.
Bhutan. तो फिर आप अभी बन के आई है ना वहाँ से पढ़ा के वहाँ पे नाइट ओके कमिंग बैक टू द पैनलिस्ट अगेन डॉक्टर रॉय आई स्टार्ट विद यू मूविंग ऑन फ्रॉम दिस एस्पेक्ट टू अनदर पार्ट ऑफ एजुकेशन विद द करेंट सिनेरियो जब स्टूडेंट्स का एस्पिरेशन लेवल बदल गया है द कनेक्टिविटी लेवल्स हैव ग्रोन अप देयर एक्सपोजर इज हाई a class 2-3 or kid has a mobile and a phone and sab kuch hai unke haath mein kuch kuch log to kitab pe chale jaate hain us age pe how has education changed over the years padhai and the teacher's approach towards kids how has that changed over time
see the education technology has changed we also use a lot of computerized teaching machine learning education based on artificial intelligence different tools at home in school but the human factor has not changed much because children actually don't come to school to study that much they can learn everything either from textbooks or from internet but they come to school for a lot of other reasons and which are human factors of life the teacher can guide them emotionally socially they when they come and meet their friends those social skills are developed you ask any small child they don't want holidays so they want to come to school particularly in today's time when most of them are single children they have no one at home to talk to both parents working so they prefer to come to school but because when they come to school they have so many 25 other children to talk to they enjoy their time so these new technology use of mobile phones particularly has posed a lot of threat for children of this age group because they are watching a whole lot of substances which are not age appropriate that are impacting their psychology but in school they when they come it is the social skills mixing up with others everything they're learning at home they many of them do not talk to anyone because parents come back very late at night and they are left alone so people are saying mobile phone is the best and cheapest babysitter So when they are coming to, consequently when they come to school, you know, my teachers have observed many children are continuously talking because they did not talk at all at home. So all these things are new issues which are coming as challenges, but as I believe teachers are ready for challenges and we find new solutions to new problems, some other social issues which are not, I do not know whether that is a fallout of any technology, but the relationship problems are coming in the society. More and more single parents are coming, and more couples are not ready to stay together. Even there are small issues they are not ready to adjust. Many of them say we are not compatible. So this is a major social change which is coming, and children are suffering for that. There is no one, we at personal level, we take care of many, but you cannot replace their lack of parental affection. I remember one child of class 9 was telling me, I don't have any issue if my father loves another woman, but why he should not love me? So I had to call that father to school, come and meet the child because he was not staying with them. So these kinds of issues come up, which are not, which are different in today's time. So technology has of course brought a whole lot of games. Children play games. They hide their parents' mobile phone even if they have their own and play PUBG at night, and then they come sleep in the morning. So all these issues are there. But more than that, human issues are more important. And my book is on that. Those children, they also have mobile phones, and that also have impacted their lives, their behavior, everything.
So since you are heading an institution, I have a question for you. How's the motivation level of the teachers? Especially, are they passionate as they used to be? Or do you think there's a dying in the passion level?
It depends a lot how your work atmosphere and whether you have clarity about your job. So I will not say things about other schools because I do not know what happens there. But in my school, when the teachers come, we do not have any hierarchical system. We say that you are a team of caregivers, and being a caregiver, you have to take care of all the children here. So if a senior child is having an emotional issue and the junior teacher can help, she will help. The motivation level remains high when you are very clear about what you are doing. If they are finding a situation difficult and they cannot discuss it with anybody else, then they may get demotivated. In that way, we are very open. We do not hesitate to share each other's problems and finding solutions together. So that is I have observed over the time that keeps the teachers motivated, and I think head also plays some roles. So when you are a teacher for a long time, it comes to your nature that I cannot give up. I have to do this. Like if your machine is not working, you just slap it, put it somehow, but you have to fix it. So they cannot afford to give up. So if you can create that culture, the motivation level remains high.
That's wonderful,
ma'am,
and Basava International is doing a wonderful
thank
job.
Thank you, come visit my school.
I've been in this profession for 32 years also myself, so
I can
understand. May I also
say something?
The company
never had
come to
the
school.
Yeah.
Now
like
every school, it's a must.
No, no.
Things have gone beyond teachers' capacity to
no,
this.
Exactly.
Exactly.
You're
not supposed to.
It's still there.
One thappad.
I personally do not believe that you have to slap or physically hurt a child. You can do that to a child because the child is, you are bigger than the child. The child cannot hit you back. You cannot do that to an adult too if you do not agree. And when you have lost the situation, then only you hit the child. So I personally don't believe in that.
That means you're not an effective teacher. I'm the same way. You're not an effective teacher. That means you're not
effective.
I think a
lot of what we're saying is for the very the metros that we are looking at. We are looking at where we are in this pretty bubble that we are in, that this is what happened and you're not supposed to. When I started teaching, I was teaching in a school in East Delhi, which was a private school, English medium. And the first PPM, and I had come from South Delhi. So my mindset was that you don't hit children, and you know that's not the done thing, you counsel them, etc. PTM में I had this set of parents who came in and he said वो आपके बारे में बहुत अच्छा बोलता है पर मैडम आप मारते नहीं हो and I was actually flabbergasted कि you know they are asking me to hit their child कि ये अब आपके हमने सौंप दिया है अब आप इसको मार मुड़ के ठीक कर दीजिए and that is the mindset it's still there so we might be wanting the best for the children but sometimes parent education जिसकी वजह से आप काउंसलर्स हो गए हैं, वी डू पेरेंट ओरिएंटेशंस एंड वी डू ऑल दैट नाउ बट आई थिंक अ लॉट ऑफ माइंडसेट ऑफ अ पेरेंट आल्सो नीड्स विद यू फॉर 6 आवर्स और 7 आवर्स
पेरेंट्स आल्सो
यस दैट्स व्हाट आई एम सेइंग नाउ यू आर राइट बिकॉज़ आई हैव आल्सो बीन अ डायरेक्टर टू द चेंज then I've seen this the parents coming up and saying ma'am aap
maarte kyun nahi ho
yes
so
that's the language not,
yeah you are not giving them that you're not that strong teacher that they want for their child. You're very soft and you know you don't hit them and that's the kind of mindset.
So but I did call one parent
when we saw the slap finger marks on the child, we called the parent and I said if I see it again I'll call HCPCR and report you. So he said he was very much surprised ki mera bachcha hai maine mara iska kya hai but then I meant it and he got it just said sorry
which is a very
simple reason because she was losing her pencils too frequently
maybe
I don't know maybe
in the past it was like a kind of expression because they don't understand what they have to do So they said, हमने अपना बेटा आपको दे दिया है ना वो ठोक पीट के ठीक करते हैं। Sort of
thing. It's same like when the radio you said the machine is not working so you just smack it twice. So it starts working. There are some kids, you know, there are some kids who are stuck sometimes. Like if I talk about my daughter, you repeatedly tell them कि इसको ऐसे करो, इसको ऐसे करो, and that's only for her to follow certain norms. But then when the child is not getting right, एक बार जब बोलते हो कि एक लगाऊंगी ठीक से हो जाएगा. And वो लगाने के डर से ही अपने आप ठीक से हो जाता है So that's what like as a child when I was small my mom used to take me to a teacher अगर कोई concept नहीं समझ में आ रहा है इसको ठोक ठाक के सीधा कर देना बस So that is the mindset from where we have come
जी,
from
बिल्कुल, yeah.
But now it has become a crime
तो probably हमारे जो बच्चे बड़े हो रहे हैं जब when they probably have kids वो नहीं मारेंगे उनको मारने का पता ही नहीं होगा हमें पता है we are the change actually हमारी generation is the change generation in a lot of things
it is a debatable topic कि you know physically मारना चाहिए नहीं मारना like
yeah हम क्यों नहीं चाहिए
yes करना चाहिए या नहीं करना चाहिए like if I talk my sports teacher वो रोज सुबह used to see her sharpening her you know
stick वो हमें उस पोटी से मारता
है वो रोज सुबह की उसी के डर से हमारे जूते सफेद हो जाते I have never seen my daughter getting scared going to school ki agar mera joota safed matlab there is no concept of white shoes only abhi to canvas shoes to hai canvas to hai tab ke time mein hum canvas joota bachane ke liye you know chahe barish ho chahe kuch ho used to hop everywhere and carry in a carry bag ye bachate le jane ki discipline that was discipline according to that time ki safed joote school pahunchne chahiye
now they are the brands that speak you know So that's it. The brand that speak and the parents divide that, but at the same time, when the child is under substance abuse, they don't even know that. We are the ones to tell them that you know there is something. We have been observing this. Can we get the blood test done? Can we get take the child?
पहले शायद 10 साल में एक चीज बदलती थी अब 10 मिनट में एक चीज बदलती है They had a very elaborate story to come back and tell us. So they were like us. उनको भी टॉपिक बड़ा किया था, अभी इसके बच्चों को टॉपिक क्यों बड़ा करते हैं? But outside टॉपिक, you don't allow that. even the act of threatening itself is punishable. So they coined a new term for kind of telling the kids that it's time you will get hit now. So they won't say that, they will not say hit you, they say you want dundu. So it became a kind of a thing in our group that, you know, this is what kids need, that, you know, they have been told this is what you will get if you don't listen to us.
The maximum you could tell them is go to a corner, because they're huge punishment.
Yeah.
But punishment does not actually help. It is kind of suppressing the problem. Yeah. So they will get conditioned to punishment. Yeah, I will be disciplined only when I get the punishment, and there is fear of punishment. And when children grow up with fear, they do not become confident. They won't be able to be in leadership position.
Yes.
So I have given full freedom to children in school. If you want to bunk, bunk. And I told teachers, if your class is boring, children will bunk. So truancy is zero in my school. They do stay in the class.
Ma'am, we have a student sitting there. She's listening to everything. She'll go back and see where this to all the class.
I say it openly to children in the assembly. So I want to be a student again in your school.
So coming back to the panel discussion again, before I open it up for questions, a last sawal jawab. The state of education that we are in, जो हमारा current scenario है education का, काफी चीजें कही जाती हैं, good, bad, ugly. What is your opinion, both of you, on the state of education that we have right now in our country?
By 2015, we were supposed to have education for all, but now even in 2020, we don't have it. And government is trying to kind of, when I was doing my research, India was amongst five countries of the world which had the largest number of children not going to school. So from that panic situation, we are getting more and more children in school. Government has also put out of school children in different private schools, the abolition of examination system and promoting everybody, putting everybody in school without even paying attention to the quality of education is just, to me, it's just like school god on the run. So if they go to school and pass out of the school, they will be given the certificate and you count their number amongst your literate people of the country. But how much they are learning, all the examination surveys show that our fifth grade children do not know the mathematics and English of class 1 level. So is this any education? We have got this academic session, we have got children from the authorities who we have taken, who did not even study in the previous class. So consequently, they do not understand even one sentence taught in the school. So when in that particular class, so when I'm contacting the department, they're saying that you can put the child in class in a class where she is appropriate. So we are taking extra care, we are taking extra classes for them. But if you see the overall situation, what is the level of learning which is taking place? What are the learning outcomes? Are they actually learning or just getting a certificate after class 10? So that people will have to think about that. Just putting children in school is not the solution to school's education problem. If we have to think about sustainable education, which will help them in doing something in life, we have to take care of quality.
Harshali.
I'm very happy with it. I am happy in the sense that more kids are going to school. Parents are wanting their children to go. What you said, what you began with, that even our house help now wants to send their children to school. So, kuch to change hai. Let's applaud that. And of course, thoda sa pahiya bhi hai ghum raha hai. Toh koi baat nahi hai, ghum to raha hai. So let's look at it like that.
And I hope more, very, very correctly you said that we need to develop on the quality, we need to start thinking on the quality. But if school mein bachche honge, tabhi quality ke baare mein bhi baat kari jayegi. So the fact that people or the government or you know, the policy makers need to think and make laws and make policies which encourage parents to send their children to school, because at that age, jis age mein bachche school jaane chahiye, it is the parents' decision. They are the ones who are sending the children. So that should be our primary aim, that the policy makers actually, very correctly you said, should make policies accordingly. The second point I wanted to say was technology, tying to your earlier question, that technology I think has really helped, wherein now you can see stories on your WhatsApp and your web, these people are teaching, you know, these children under the flyovers and all that. Wo pehle hame kahan dekhne ke liye milta tha. So a lot of people are also, because now everybody has a phone, aware that, you know, and they are getting motivated ki, oh, that person is, you know, they have a shop, but shaam ko bachon ko niche padha rahe hain, slum children ko. So why not we can also do something? In fact, from our own society, there was a lady who got inspired and she opened a school for all the children in Kotipur area. And we all try and help her wherever, whoever can go during that period of time, we all try and go and help with whatever we can do. So I think technology also, if used in the correct way, for example, in this case, can help a lot.
Saki, how much time do we have?
Can I open it up and interact with you? Okay. Ek sawal, I'm sure aap logo ke man mein hai, since we have one educator, one principal of the school, what role should a parent play in bringing up a child? Parents ka kya role hota hai? Aur unki, if I ask you, agar unki top 3 चीजें जो उन्हें करनी चाहिए बच्चों के लिए, वो क्या होगा?
First of all, earlier the current generation used to learn from previous generation, but that whole system has changed. So parents currently do not have anyone to learn from. So as a substitute, they should learn from the books. There are lots of good parenting books. They can also, there are lots of portals they can take help. Most of our parents are not skilled to rear children. They are very much affectionate. They have unending love for their children, but they're lacking skills. And they are not very much aware that they are lacking skills. So skill formation of parents is very, very essential. You can do that by reading books, by forming new kind of groups, like very young women who are not getting married or who are both working, and they are having children, they either adopted or have their own children. They are, this concept is coming into view that they have a group parenting system. So if you do not have a joint family system, but you have a group parenting system, that may help, because staying alone, you are taking the, when you are going to watch a movie, you are taking the child along to watch an adult movie. But if you have a support of your other friends, then you can take each other's help and can keep the child with the friend and go and watch movies. So all these new things are there, and technology, the young parents are tech savvy, but a little older parents, like parents of 9th, 10th classes or class 8 even, they are not very tech savvy and they think that they can do without. So consequently, when a child has done some mistake on social media, the parents are not aware, and they also do not know how to handle that situation. So we do a lot of intervention at that level, like if the one child posted a wrong and inappropriate picture on Instagram, so she came seeking help from teacher only, because parents are not helpful. When I called father, he said, I asked, are you aware that your child is just 13 years old, he's on Instagram? Yes. Kaise pata chala? Usne bataya. So they do not monitor what their children are doing on phone. That is very much essential. And also, we should not
parents should not be authoritative, because if children want to do something, you can convince them that is not good for you. So you should have proper communication skills. Most parents do not have proper communication skills. So they will say, aapko ye nahi karna, kyun? Main bola na. So this does not work out with children. Earlier children never replied back. These days they either reply back or it creates distance between the parents and the child. So these three things I think are very, very important for parents.
Social media, I think you will be the only generation. You will teach your children and your parents. Social media, how to use it and how to use it.
There is a story of Sudha
movie
where
yes.
grandmother.
Yes,
yeah.
absolutely.
Yeah.
But I have a question on a lighter note. Most common problem with all kids is they don't eat.
The answer is very simple. Mother should know how to cook good food and not eat.
Yes.
No, that's not right. That's
unfair.
No, that's very unfair. Because most of the time, if you have a working woman, if you have parents who are working,
so what?
Mother will not cook, right?
So
what?
All over the world, women are working.
I think you're surrounding your wife
by
saying
Why
no, 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 it is okay. By mother, I meant parent only. It can be father also. Because you become a good mother, excellent mother, when you can cook well, because all your child's friends will love you. And same with the father.
Now she's become a little bit.
We can eat sandwiches every day.
Coming to you, Harshali, आपके तीन points क्या हैं, तीन suggestions क्या हैं?
सबसे पहले तो यार helicopter parent बनना बंद करो।
I
was you know as
helicopter parent
होता है क्या? So I was when I was handling preschool, so I had four preschools under me and I was going from one school to the other and there was this constant कि ma'am we have organized a parent discussion with you. And all the parents, all they wanted to talk about was, oh, he doesn't do this, he doesn't do this, we have to constantly be after his life, our life. And so, I said, why don't you just leave them alone for some time? I mean, katori jamban se khel sakenge wo. You don't need to provide entertainment for them 24/7. Matlab, kabhi ye class ja rahe hai, kabhi, just give them the space to be whatever they do, whatever they want to do. Jo me time hum bade hoke dhoond rahe hain, wo pehle de do yaar bachchon ko. So that is my number one, and that was my pet peeve because I couldn't make them understand, especially for a first time parent. I understand it's very difficult because you are reading so much. And I'll give you a small example. In India, when we have a baby, the first thing you're taught is you sleep with the baby, right? When I was a mother, that is what keep, you know, makes a fast rapport, and you know, the baby should smell you and things like that. When my sister had the baby outside, I was with her during the time and she was, you know, weaning the baby away. And there was this thing called letting the baby cry and sleep. And so her pediatrician had suggested to her, okay, ab bachcha bada ho gaya, ab isko cot mein dalo aur tum log bahar aa jao. And imagine the three of us standing outside, letting the baby cry and said, I wanted to pull my hair out because I said, let me go back, you do whatever you want to do. And now that study has been proved to be wrong and traumatic to the children because and there's a full study on that. And that link I sent to her, I said, Bhaiya, you have messed up majorly. And you know, so that's what I mean. That I mean, without even understanding what you are doing, you are blindly following what someone else has written. Especially for parenting, I feel there are no rules here. You should do what you feel is comfortable, the child is comfortable. You cannot read a book. Yes, you can get a blueprint. Aapko ye pata chal sakta hai ki ye mat karo, ye mat karo. But you cannot, you know, it's not tailor-made. You have to tailor-make it for your child. You can't be ki aap kitab padh rahe ho ya ek article padh ke ki aaj se main ye nahi karungi. I mean, I never suggest that. I never say, I said, okay, read it. Take what is good, what you can, you know, you can apply in your life, but don't go crazy because someone else somewhere sitting in their own life has written that book. Especially because the parenting books which had come out, they had come from authors who were sitting outside. Their set of rules and their life was very different than what Indian parents were living.
So expecting that aap wahi cheeze yahan karoge was like living in the fool's paradise. So that was my first. So in the orientation, when we used to have orientation with parents, these are the two things I used to tell them. I said, read parenting books, but be very careful. You are adults. You have children. So don't just put everything and start doing those things.
It's formulas basically.
Yeah.
You know, key formula is.
It's not chemistry. Please don't use it like that.
That was my second thing.
And the third thing is that children teach you on their own. They'll tell you that they like something or they don't. Probably because I've dealt more with very young children, I probably talk from their level, and while you, I think, are talking more from the adolescent level. But as I said, that it starts, you know, the building block starts when they're the youngest, you know, at that age, when they're looking for love, they're looking for appreciation, they're looking for acceptance. That is number one. I mean, you have to accept your child and their needs before your own. Because a lot of time now I've seen that young parents are unable to put their children's needs before theirs. You know, they feel ki are hamari to azadi chhin gayi, and the child is sitting there. So I want to tell them that your child is seeing everything, hearing everything that you are doing. So if you are talking rudely to that child's mother, that child is observing that. So you are the role model. So tum hero ho. Ab soch lo tumne usko kya wo dena hai.
Context, I would like to ask you, what is your opinion about play schools and preschools? I mean, is it really necessary?
I think so, yes. Not for the studies. Not for the studies,
because
in
the
Indian context,
is happening. It's taking away the closeness of parental listening.
See, from the parents are already working.
Yeah.
I'm going to talk about metros now. So if I say about metro, because now play school has also gone into the rural area.
Yes, but not necessarily working with
the play school. So now there is another thing which is called as daycare come play school.
Yes.
Wherein the parents go and drop their child, and till 4 o'clock they're doing some kind of activity which is prescribed, and you know, they get worksheets, etc. I don't think that's a bad idea, because the child is gainfully, you know, and concentrated in that. If both the parents are working, normally nanny hogi, ya nanny ke saath grandmother hogi, ya, because now most of the parents, if both parents are working, they're able to afford a house help. And so you don't know what kind of stuff the maid is teaching. So the parent is anyways meeting the child in the evening only. So isn't it better that they are under a professional watch, wherein there are teachers who are helping? And not only that, as she very rightly said, we have only one or maximum two children now. So they don't have anybody to play with. If you have 4 kids in a daycare or in a play school, you are at least getting to meet your peers. So it does help.
It's mandatory now. It's like
they come
in
here.
You're not working.
No,
I think
it's a good idea. I think it's a good idea, because one, it increases your independence level. What happens in the house, even if, as you're saying, the mother is at home, बेटा ये खा ले. Now there are 2 reasons for that. The mother will try and, I'm not blaming anybody, no judgment at all, but I've seen that on television from my experience, that they will want कि मेरे को next काम करना है, तो मैं जल्दी जल्दी खिला दूँ, right? And why actually it should be that you're training the child कि खुद खाओ, right? And sit with the child, which the teacher might do in the daycare. I'm sorry, take more time. But you know, so these are the pluses that I'm looking at. Yes, there are many negatives. I'm not going to deny that everything has a plus and a minus. But for this particular thing, I've always found the positives to be more than the negatives.
Great. And Sashi has mentioned that if you ask a question, she'll give you a comment from that box there. She's hungry.
I just wanted to ask one question, because as you are more experienced, I have a 10 years old son, and there is one word which is majorly used these days, but according to me it's misused, that word, and misunderstood as well by children and by adults as well. But I would like to know how the schools are dealing with this word, and that word is bullying. Okay, so these days children say we're bullying each other, okay? They just do a little bit of हमारे टाइम में क्या होता था भाई थप्पड़ पड़ा भाई बहन से लड़ाई हुई तो भी सोटे दोस्तों से लड़ाई हुई वो भी सोटे but as these days kids what they're saying they're strangling each other or they're saying you're shorty or you're fat so they the terminology is called bullying each other, which is not a good word, and a lot of kids are suffering from that. But then it's our schools are doing something about that, because as I said, my son is 10 years old and he's gonna grow. So these things will grow as well. According to us, we've done the best thing, we put him in the very good school. But then is there any policy towards bullying? How teachers are dealing with it, or is it something the parents can do?
Along with that,
we
can also discuss body shaping.
Yes, the body shaping is
with the
you
mean
directly?
Okay.
Anyone
who could answer?
There are two types of bullying. One is silent and one is open bullying. Open bullying is rather easier to address, because you see that, you counsel the child, you make the child understand. But silent bullying, particularly in terms of body shaming and color, skin color, they make groups and they do not allow the child to enter that group. So that is very difficult. For bullying in most of the schools, lots of work is going on. You have to address those issues directly, because when there is silent bullying, it is not done by one single child. When it is open bullying, it is done by mostly one or two children together. So it is easier to handle. Also, additionally, these days we are having cyber bullying, which is even more difficult. So, and also children have been using abuse words, which are earlier words of abuse were related to anger of the child. But these days they are using the words because it's cool, because all the heroes on Netflix and Hindi movies are using those words. So by using that word on a movie, in a movie or on social media, the word is getting social sanction. So children of 10, 11 years old, they do not understand the meaning of that word, but everybody is using, so we are also using. So these kinds of bullying, there are counselors, but teachers are good counselors. So constantly you will have to talk to the child, and we have to make the child understand that what is the meaning of this word, if you are, or what is the consequence of your this particular gesture. If you are physically strong and hitting somebody else, somebody who is even more physically stronger will hit you. So there is no end to it. If we can make this, make the children understand this at a lower age, we can to some extent stop this, but it is not one, it's a very complicated situation.
But is there any policy the schools are using?
Yes, of course.
Counselors who, you know,
all good schools have counselors, all good schools have discipline rules. So counseling is done at length. Sometimes the counseling goes to parents also. Sometimes the child is bullied at home. That I was saying, that if you are bullying the child or hitting the child, it has far-reaching consequences. And cyberbullying, for using bad words, I addressed the children once. I would like to share. I said, you know about POPSO? So all the bad words that you use are related to that. So anybody using this word, as the principal, I'm supposed to report to police. So sometimes these kinds of bullying by principal also. Also words out. But there were deeper issues also. In one particular year, we had some middle school children, 6th, 7th and 8th, they were very aggressive and bullying actually. So I was just raking my head how to handle that. So I had personally called them, about 15 children I think we had. One of them, they do not actually know how to handle their particular emotion at that point, I came to know. So I said, from now on, you are on principal's team, we'll call you. I got them badges made. So if you do anything bad, it will be my fault. And if you do something good, it will be my credit. And I also sorted out their individual issues, like a child had dark complexion and people used to, this is one major issue of bullying. So I said, if anybody says anything to you, you just say thank you. How does the skin color make a difference? So that child will have to understand that if my skin color is different, it doesn't matter. But small children do not understand that. So over 1 year time, all of them got very disciplined. So constant counseling is very much essential. All schools have discipline rules written in the almanac, which children are so small, they do not, even if they have read and learned, they will do it. So it's a constant and continuous process.
Okay,
yeah.
Very short.
Exposure, because ultimately trophy will be with the child only in the house. So it is maybe teacher had that intention in mind that it will be when children go for different kinds of competitions outside the school, they get exposure which make them confident in for life. And also when they appear for those international, national level examinations, that they get their ranking and they get to know where they stand. So, but of course, if a child is not willing to be part of a competition and she is happy with whatever she has been doing, she should be left to do that.
Yeah, but my question was, the child didn't want to go to school for like next 3 days. Then what do I say to my teacher?
The child was victimized, that's what she tried
that's
to say.
That's
the entire year, the child.
That's a bad thing. I mean, no one should be victimized.
That leaves a bad taste. That leaves
a bad taste.
Taste.
That leaves a bad taste. Okay, fine. The child may be good at
what did you do?
Yeah.
What did you do?
So I had to really take it out. I had to put my foot down and I went to the teacher that, no, I know. And she tried to convince me that she can do it. I said, of course she can do it. Ask her to play because she can do it. The point is, if she wants to do it, she can do it. Or something she doesn't want to do. She doesn't want to. Like, please understand, that's not her choice. That's not her favorite subject, perhaps. But she doesn't want to do it. So it becomes, you know, a matter of prestige for the teacher also that I have taught her, she's my brightest student, and she should do it. Where is the freedom of choice for the child?
No, there should be full freedom of choice.
Yes,
and children should be allowed to express their freedom of choice.
I guess we are losing out there, ma'am, actually, but that's the reason why we are suffering from brain drain when it comes to the higher level of education.
I told you, parents, bullying of children starts from home.
Ma'am, do you have each one program in your school?
No, not now.
Okay. Well, that's also pretty good, you know, like especially those...
My teachers are very, I have parents expressing this, that if I say anything negative to that teacher, they will be taking it out on my child. But I do not know if whether my teachers are taking it out on the children, but I hope they don't do it because we have a lot of counseling. And but it happens, yes. Even as parent, I also have the fear that if I say something it will go against my child. That is, I think, is a perpetual fear in the minds of all parents.
So they don't have like a box
where they
can try to speak to the counselor also, but then ultimately, fine, obviously, the child doesn't want to.
But as you were so rightly putting it, that you probably had to face that fear was inside you for the rest of the year.
Yeah.
And you know, you probably face, because eventually that lady is also human, right?
Yeah.
So she is going to have her
Yes,
going to want to put it. So I got that. But if you go towards the constructive, you know, positive of this, maybe you can suggest to the school that for parents, you can have, if they want to suggest something, not only for complaining, but for a suggestion, maybe an anonymous suggestion box can be there which the principal can open and then check.
So that's something that we have to do as a parent, you know.
Yes. So you would have that parent.
Yeah. But now the child has to be there with the teacher for the entire year. So that becomes really difficult for them. It's very difficult for the child to understand and deal with such a situation that we, the
that's
child.
Yeah. Sad you had to go through that.
Yeah.
But a lot of parents go through that.
Yeah.
I had to change my daughter's school because of a small reason. First week of school in the new session started, the child got late for say 2 minutes, 3 minutes, and she was asked to stand up, and the teacher scolded her. And another girl, because she was a teacher's daughter, she was allowed to walk past inside. 2 days consecutively this happened, and my daughter refused to go to school after paying the whole academic fee. I had to change her school. Every morning she would just cry. And this is one of the prominent schools in Dwarka. And in spite of several complaints to them, they had no answer. I didn't get a call. And I had to change my daughter's school.
Sadly, education has been taken away from consumer.
Yeah.
Counselor for their kid. Spend that half an hour with your child when the child comes home.
The main problem sometimes is that everybody gets so caught up with, you know, the whole day's work and everything.
Yes.
Sometimes teachers, because as I said, they're human, right? So they have their whole system. But I agree that as a human being, the first thing should be to spend those 5 minutes with the mother who's having that issue. I mean, as, you know, all teachers become counselors by the end of it. Within the first year, they are well trained to handle whoever are teachers, they are know what I'm talking about. So I think that wo lacking ho gaya. Earlier, we were allowed to talk to parents very openly. We could talk to them, we could give suggestions, we could have that one-on-one. Abhi kya ho gaya that there is that boundary, there is a filter where, because so much has come in terms of complaints, etc., and people are taking cases and everything. So, you know, everybody's got scared. So, I'm not saying that it's anybody's fault, but it's just one of those things that, you know, these are the things which go through the cracks.
Come
and which should not.
I'd like to mention one point to you that do not put your child in comparison to anyone. You maybe you felt upset that teacher's child was allowed to go in. Maybe the teacher was late that day and child comes along with the teacher, so it was not the child's fault. But when you have any issue, you must approach the right authorities and sort it out. Again, I'll have to talk with reference to our school only. When children come late, it is an act of indiscipline actually. They are mostly not late because of themselves. Small children are late because their parents get late.
Yes.
And small children come to school from, most of the time, walking children are late. So this is a major issue to look into. And parents often drop them at the gate and drive away. So what we do if child comes late, we take them in and we call the parent and ask them to come and collect the child. So after 2 days, parent has done this, they will drop the child on time. And also one odd day a child which comes regularly to school on time, one odd day the child may be late because of any XYZ reason. So we should take exception to that.
Any more questions? Yours alone? Okay, great. So we have a surprise for the end, which nobody knows, even Sakshi doesn't know. We have a wonderful singer amongst us. And that happens to be Harshali. And she's kindly consented to sing a few lines for us to close this wonderful session. So Harshali, over to you.
The word brain drain, but I will just sing a few lines. I hope it goes okay.
With their books, Dr. Manimala Roy with From Shanties to School and Dr. Harshali Singh with The Anatomy of Choice. The books are available on Amazon and in bookstores. Please do go pick them up and read them. They're lovely books. And thank you for being such a nice audience. It was lovely having you. Photographs? Yeah, the photo. Thank you so much. And have a great evening ahead. Thanks.